In order to talk about what's going on in network protocols, it helps to have a bit of a visual language. Just as we might use a line graph to depict a financial trend, or a histogram to show the distribution of a variable, there's a particular kind of chart that's useful for illustrating network protocols. It's called a sequence diagram, and here's an example. This is a diagram of an HTTP connection using KeepAlive. These two lines on the left and right are timelines, with time advancing from the top to the bottom. The line on the left represents the client's view of the world. The line on the right is the server's view of the world. And these arrows between them represent messages sent from the client to the server, or from the server to the client. You'll sometimes see them drawn at an angle, which serves to remind you that messages are never instantaneous. There's always latency or lag time between when the client sends something and the server receives it, or vice versa. But conventionally, they're drawn straight, and we just have to remember that time never goes backwards. Now, because we haven't invented time travel, anything that either end does at any point in time can only be affected by things that that end has already seen. Like, if the client sends two requests, and the server starts responding to the first one as soon as it sees it, the server can't change its first response on the basis of the second request. It hasn't seen that second one yet. Sequence diagrams remind us to keep things in order, and to make sure that our notions of what's going on in the network don't assume that servers can see the future. So here's what's going on in this diagram. The client sends an HTTP GET request with a connection KeepAlive header. The server sends a response, and once the client has received that response, it can send another request over the same connection, and so on. Here's the thing, though. A sequence diagram always represents some particular level of a protocol. Like, here's a diagram for just one request at the HTTP layer with an HTTP GET and a response. But this doesn't show individual IP packets. And I assure you that if that response is a download of a 6 MB file, it's not going to happen as simply as just one arrow suggests. When we look deeper into the stack, we'll find that one exchange on the HTTP level may be a shorthand for a bunch of exchanges on a lower level. In fact, let's take a closer look at that right now.